a vast, mysterious universe, there spins a small planet, inhabited by a variegated human family. Originally, the leaders were shamans and priests who claimed connection to powerful, unseen gods. But in time, a democratic, secular nation came into existence. Food for Thought Productions is pleased to present this program designed to remind one and all that ours is that secular nation, as spelled out in the First Amendment to our Constitution, which begins, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion," and that our national pledge stated, "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." The phrase, "under God," was not included. Also, our official national motto, which was devised by founding fathers Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, and John Quincy Adams in 1776, was "E pluribus unum," out of many, one. Three unlikely traditionalists, Phillip Dulin Jones, Ben Edward Akerley, and our producer Lee Baker, present the case for restoration of our original pledge and motto.
Hello, I'm just so happy to have some good friends with me today to talk about a subject that is so dear to my heart and to theirs as well. And I want to welcome you, Ben Akerley, and Phillip Dulin Jones.
Oh, thank you.
It's really wonderful to see how you have been able to fit all of this activity into your busy schedule. Because even though you're retired as a professor from USC, I know that you're a working musician, and I know that you've written books, and we've done shows on your books. So now this is the big deal, the restoration of the campaign. And I'm very happy that you're with us, because
you've done a lot
of research on this and have a background in research that you've done at University of California at Irvine.
Right.
And so how is it that so many people don't realize that the Pledge of Allegiance is not the original pledge that was designed by founding fathers in 1776, nor is the motto?
Well, because nobody really told them. You know, when I was going to school, no one ever brought it up that these changes, adding religious phrases to the national motto and the Pledge of Allegiance.
They were added under God.
Yes.
But you thought it was always.
Always, there. Yes. I thought those were the traditional pledges, and so did everybody else, because no one said a thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not even adults other than teachers who were alive at that time and knew enough to know that these
now,
laws could have been passed.
You started school after the 50s when this
yes.
all, the change
in
all
1960.
Happened. And you did some research after you,
right.
recently.
Right.
What got you started? What got you into it?
Well, I started going to these secular humanist of Los Angeles meetings, and it just so happened at one of them there was this speaker, Lance Jenks, who was talking about this very subject, and that's the first that I'd ever heard of it.
And that was not very long ago.
No, that was only 4 or 5 months ago.
You know,
I was 42 years old, and I'd never known that.
Never realized.
Realized that these mottos were new additions.
Right,
you know,
absolutely
over
new.
A period of about 10 years or so
mm-hmm.
that it took, the process.
Now, Lance Jenks, you work with Lance quite a bit, and he's really gung-ho with this. With the email all over the country, and he's just established a new website. We can furnish that to people. They call the number at the end of the screen, at the end of the program. What is going on nationwide? It's not just we three that are up to this, that are concerned about this campaign. You did some publicity about it yourself.
Well, I just felt that it was an unacceptable legacy from the McCarthy era.
Right.
And that anything that remained from the McCarthy era should be looked at very suspiciously.
Mm-hmm.
Because we refer to that as the worst purge in American history. It's also called the Great Fear, when everybody saw a communist under every rock, as it were. Nothing but paranoia prevailed. Even homosexuals fired wholesale from the State Department because it was not only immoral to be a homosexual, it was unpatriotic.
Oh!
And un-American.
Mm-hmm. And they were considered a security risk.
Oh, absolutely, of
course.
But
I heard Gore Vidal recently said the only safe people as far as national security would be gays because they know how to keep a secret.
That's right. That's right. So, it's in the genes.
So this, you did research on,
yes,
when these changes took place. How could they change such a significant set of national the pledge and the motto are so integral to expressing what our country's about?
Well, they just put them into seemingly minor enactments. The government.
Who is they?
The House of Representatives and the Senate.
And so the Congress, both houses.
Yes, both houses. And there had been some laws as early as World War II, certain court cases, but the first really significant law was this Section 453. It was a part of a huge title of laws that were passed in 1948 on June the 25th, and it required a religious test for a federal justice or judge, mm-hmm, to accept their office as part
but
of their oath of office.
That's also in contradiction.
Yes.
Did you find out which article that was that says there should be no test? I know that, I believe it's Article 6.
6 of the Constitution, mm-hmm, yes. That there won't be a religious test. It's mm-hmm, Article 6, Section 3, I think.
So that's mm-hmm why we've dubbed ourselves the true traditionalists. We want to go back to our Constitution, back to our roots.
The real traditionalists.
Yes.
I think it's important to remember that as soon as Eisenhower got into office, the Hearst newspaper chain began a campaign to add these words under God.
Mm-hmm.
Because again, there was a communist under every rock, as it were, and they felt that we had to assert ourselves as the enemy of a godless power like communism, and therefore we were not only a God-fearing nation, but almost a theocracy in the sense that we were under God. We were his chosen special people. And Phillip, back to your congressional thing, I think it's also important to mention there was not a single dissension when the pledge under God words were added. Not a single congressman or senator abstained or voted against it. And I think that's very significant. It just shows what the climate was, that everybody was terrified of being considered unpatriotic, un-American, unsympathetic to Christian values.
Mm-hmm. So this climate in the 50s, when all of this change, both of these changes came into being, was before you started school.
Right.
So naturally, when you started school, the curriculum was affected.
Well, yeah,
by
was,
this different approach to patriotism.
Yeah. And don't forget the third important change of In God We Trust being added to the money. That was sandwiched in. In 54, we had the pledge change under God. In 56, we had the secular A Pluribus Unum motto replaced. But in between, sandwiched in between in 55, Eisenhower mandated that the words "In God We Trust" be on all currency. So there were three major changes, one year right after the other, three consecutive mm-hmm years mm-hmm of these major changes.
Now, do you remember the Hollywood 10 the witch hunt that McCarthy created?
Yes.
And that really was based on the fact that the bosses in Hollywood were trying to break the union. They always say unions are communist inspired because what they really want to do is get rid of the unions. And writers they're not good follower types.
Party line types.
So anyway, it really was a matter of not saying unions or writers or creative people are bad, but because they are communists, and they were
sure
dubbed communists,
right,
so that they could be attacked.
Well, and you know, what struck me was how minor these changes seemed, and going through these law books. There's a whole series of them called United States Statutes at Large, and I bet very few people know that it exists. It's outside constitutional lawyers or political science faculty or people like that. I was really struck how these laws that are actually really important because they change the whole psychological and philosophical foundation of our country are just slipped in among all these other laws, so they don't look very important.
Right.
But they're the most, probably the most important laws of all of those volumes of laws that were passed. I mean, huge books like Oxford dictionaries, you know, full of these laws, and yet these are probably the most fundamental changes in 200 years or since our country was founded.
They sneak those in.
Yes.
Well, that's why we want to put a spotlight on.
It's insidious.
The situation.
It's insidious.
Because,
it's done.
Well,
The real
danger of this and why it was so important for them to get it in, those people that managed to get God into our government. When we say in God we trust on our money, you know, and in our pledge, is because they want to shift from the Constitution that we have to the Bible as the basis for our laws. That's why all of the battles over issues like same-sex marriages or people's reproductive choice and all of these things, those are all biblical ideas which are not a part of what the majority of the people in this democratic country.
No, I don't think they would, because they don't really understand what going back to a Old Testament morality would mean. Like Robert Dornan in a speech said something about that, and I wonder if he even knows what that really entails, is severe punishment for what we would consider misdemeanors.
Well, let me bring a little light on this subject. In the year 1950, the beginning of the decade that we're talking about, the Great Fear Decade, the McCarthy era, the Uniform Code of Military Justice was established. And in the Uniform Code of Military Justice, they ruled that adultery would be punished by 1 year in prison, and sodomy would be punished by up to 5 years imprisonment.
Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting, to show how biblical-based they were, is the sodomy covered any acts between anybody. In other words, a married couple that were engaging in non-genital sex,
or any kind
of sodomy, oral, anal, and so forth.
Anything other than the missionary position
could be given 5 years in a military jail.
Mm-hmm.
And today, 1998, as we are facing the turn of the millennium, even though most of our states now have repealed their sodomy laws, that Uniform Code of Military Justice is still in effect and is one of the reasons that the military was unable to lift the ban against gays, because after all, they're breaking a federal law. They're guilty of a federal crime if they participate in a in a non-heterosexual or even a heterosexual sodomic act. So again, that couldn't have happened. I can't imagine that law.
All of that is from these fundamentalist type Christians wanting to make the laws, make the rules for everybody.
You know, and I found out that in this book called Freedom Under Siege that there were even direct laws against practicing atheism. I haven't found out that much about it yet.
How do you practice atheism? Atheism is not practicing.
Well, against us.
It's not practicing anything.
Embracing atheism.
It was an amendment that was almost, that was passed by the House but not by the Senate, that it was called the Ashbrook Amendment, and it said that any employer finding out that, you know, if any of his employees were atheists, that he could terminate their employment. Mm. And then there was another action later on, I think in the 1960s, it was called the Murray Decision of the Federal Communication Commission, that said that atheists didn't have the same right of free speech as other citizens in respect to the media. I think it was in 1966, if I'm not mistaken.
66.
Yes. Yes. And the other one was earlier, like in 1954, around the same time as all these other amendments to the pledge and motto were happening.
A friend of mine actually sat in on the McCarthy hearings, and he said that the fear was palpable. You could literally feel it in the air, that this senator had this unlimited power to just literally destroy people's lives, and people were shaking in their boots just by virtue of having been called before.
And having all of this power that, you know, could be used against them.
Of course. And I think a good way to look at the 50s
you
is...
You can't be a free person, you can't have a free nation when people become so frightened that they're paralyzed.
Of course, of course.
And that's, I think that's what's behind the idea of instilling fear against gays, fear against people having reproductive choice.
Sure.
It's not just women
right.
who want to have reproductive choice. There are many men who cannot afford more children.
Since many of our viewers probably do not remember the 50s, I think it's very interesting to contrast what happened with the two Kinsey reports. The first Kinsey report, the volume on sexual behavior in the human male, came out in 48.
Mm-hmm.
And there was some moral outcry, people like Margaret Mead saying, well, I don't know if this would be good in the hands of youth and all this and all that. But the Rockefeller Foundation that had funded the report still stood their ground and everything held steady, and Kinsey went right on to do the female report. Now, the female report came out in 53, and all of a sudden, there was a comment, not just because nobody wanted to believe that women really did what the report said they did, but there was a danger that this would undermine the morals of our country, that our youth would be corrupted just by the existence of this report. And the Rockefeller Foundation pulled out. They stopped funding Kinsey's work, and he was to have gone on and done many other things.
Mm-hmm.
So just in that change from the 48 volume to the 53 volume, and again, that would never have happened if this insane climate of paranoia and fear did not prevail, and moral turpitude and moral underpinnings and keeping our youth morally the rectitude of moral youth and all that, that change in just that short period is dramatic. Wow. It's remarkable.
The thing is that all of these individual little changes, you know, the laws about abortion, the laws about same-sex marriage, the laws against homosexuals, all of these prayer in school vouchers, all of these issues that the radical religious right, because mainstream Christians and members of all the other religious sects are not in agreement with this political, radical fundamentalist group that's trying to control the laws of the country.
Well, you have to be careful there, Lee, because just a month ago, the Church of England decided that homosexuality could not be condoned.
Mm-hmm.
And this is supposed to be one of the most liberal congregations and liberal denominations in existence.
Mm-hmm.
And yet they're saying all of a sudden they're having second thoughts about homosexual behavior. Now, you can be homosexual as long as you are abstinent.
Right.
And you don't do anything.
Well, what I'm saying is...
And the Lutheran Church is wrestling with this. The Presbyterian Church is wrestling with it. So, unfortunately, it doesn't confine itself strictly to the radical right and the fundamentalist groups. It's even seeped into so-called mainline and liberal
churches. I think that's part of their strategy of
religious
right is to fight a lot of little battles and keep winning inch by inch by cutting into these, especially like civil rights. You know, they have this movement out now, campaign against late-term abortion, is it called?
Mm-hmm.
And you see, that's a foot in the door to get into finally banning abortion, any
altogether.
Kind of abortion.
Well, this campaign of gaining control of the country and gaining control of our government and our laws and so forth and so on, and it's bit by bit chipping away at this wall.
So it makes it seem not very important.
Yes.
You know, these seemingly trivial little changes add up, and it creates a psychological impact on people.
Right.
They finally accept it.
The reason that I think it's so important, I'm sure both of you do and a lot of other people that are getting concerned about the motto and the pledge, being religion-based is because that creates the impression that this is a Christian nation, and that's a misconception. Well, this is a democratic, secular nation.
But God is on our side.
Well, especially with recent immigrants
to
this.
That's the main point.
You know, with recent immigrants to this country, in respect to them, when they learn about the pledge and the motto and everything, they think that that's the way it was too, that they don't know about any of these changes.
They didn't know this happened recently.
Yeah, the immigrants
it was about 180 years we had the original.
You know, these immigrants from Asia and Latin America and other countries don't realize it, and they think this is
they feel like outsiders.
Well, you know,
That's not right.
I just watched a program that, you know, that's going on in France between Islam and the secular government of France. You know, there's this conflict, but it's the same thing. The danger I fear of this kind of sectarianism and fundamentalist extremism is that it will pit one religion or one sect of a religion against each other, and all kinds of sects, like the mainstream denominations. Well, you know, they're not Christian enough. And then there are all of these others. Other
That's
religions,
what
like
the Pope said
like
when
Buddhism,
Martin Luther left.
Yes. You know, it's any of these other faiths. Mm-hmm. If a government like a theocracy would come to power here, all non-Christian faiths would be persecuted.
At risk.
As well as Christians who are considered too moderate or too liberal.
Mm-hmm.
So it would end up attacking everybody, nearly.
Well, that's what happens in the Middle Eastern countries and in Ireland. And through the centuries, the bloodshed, the wars...
Well, yeah, to put that...
...over religious differences...
Well, and to put that in context, it's probably a struggle that may go back beyond history. It seemed like there's this conflict between a secular king... and a non-secular priest, or that there's
this...
religious, you know, a leader as opposed to the temporal leader that may go back to the first chieftain who questioned a shaman's view, you know.
Well, it goes back to the priest Samuel and the king Saul.
Yes, it was one of the first major historical records
that we have
of that kind of conflict where the king wants a role for himself, just for himself,
and
just
the people
for the state.
They want a person who they can hold accountable.
Yes. And
how can you hold
God
accountable?
Yes. You know, it's too nebulous. So there's been this conflict throughout history. When Socrates was on trial in Athens, it was after the disastrous Peloponnesian War against Sparta. And again, there was this fear mentality there where the 30 tyrants, the oligarchs that took over the government of Athens, wanted to go back to the more primitive, intolerant type of polytheistic religion. And they brought up, that was one of the main charges against Socrates, was that he denied the existence of the gods, as well as corrupting the youth of Athens. And then the next major conflict was between the secular power of the Roman Empire and Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
And Christianity.
Well, it goes all the way back.
Yes.
So, but now, when are we going to get past it? And that's the thing. Now, for instance, I thought that the original motto, which was created in 1776, E Pluribus Unum, from many, one, well, now we're much more many.
Of course.
And we all have to work and live together as one people. And that's why that motto is so important, that we get the idea that
we're
all different.
Diversity.
We're all valuable. We all are going to share this space. And we need to work together and not be trying to impose our ideas on someone else. We should be able to think and have our own ideas as long as they don't conflict with the rights of others.
You know, I was a believer, a religious believer at one time, and...
We forgive you.
Thank you. that's very godly of you. The point I wanted to make is that, you know, since I became interested in skepticism and atheism and rationalism, I really have an appreciation for what it feels like to be a minority. You know, mm-hmm. like a homosexual person or a person of another race or mm-hmm. recent immigrants or something like that, or people who mm-hmm. are persecuted, you know, a hated minority.
Right.
And it's really heightened the level of concern that I feel about a theocracy taking over, because it would directly influence my life
exactly.
in a very, probably a very unpleasant, nasty way.
Well, it's already, as I say, it's already affecting our lives. But I think the importance of this campaign to have our original pledge, which was really a good pledge, one nation, indivisible,
and
with liberty and justice.
The original motto is a beautiful motto.
And the motto is so perfect. And what I hope is that what we are accomplishing with this program and as the campaign goes on, and I know that Lance has a website that he's constantly in touch with people all over the nation. And lots of people are just becoming aware of the fact of our original pledge, which was beautiful, and our original motto, which is perfect for our multicultural country as it is today. So.
And Lee, I like your comment made to me not too long ago that we have to win this campaign in the court of public opinion. We have to make people aware.
We have to win in the court of public opinion.
Yes, because well, so many people aren't aware. They simply are not aware of how insidiously this happened. And they've heard of McCarthy, and they know what a terrible stain that is
that
on
was.
Our history.
Right.
And to think that we have this legacy from
McCarthy. And now we're kind
McCarthy.
Of slipping into some of those kinds
yes.
of...
Well, there's, you know, and even, you know, this Freedom From Religion Foundation tried to get a court case going to restore pledge and motto.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't even get a chance their day in court. The Supreme Court just dismissed the case.
Oh, they didn't
In 1994.
Hear it. Oh.
They didn't even hear the case. And, you know, even if that keeps happening, I still think it's really important to let people know.
Mm. I think that they're going to have to hear cases if there is enough public awareness
yes.
and enough public opinion that they want some of these things addressed, and that's what we need to win in the court of public opinion.
And it may take a long time, but I think people should still keep
well,
at it.
Well, just keep chipping
yes.
away.
They've chipped away.
We can't keep chipping away anymore today because we've run out
yes.
of time. But we'll do this again as this campaign builds and continues on, and you're working very closely with Lance, and I think you and I and a lot of us
yes.
are going to be becoming much more active because it's just so important. Well, thanks for being here.
My pleasure.
Thanks,
thank
Phillip. Till next time.
We hope you have found this program intellectually stimulating, and that you will continue to investigate the ideas raised here. To connect with other like-minded individuals, please contact any of the dozens of free thought organizations, such as the American Humanist Association, American Atheists, the Center for Inquiry, and Atheists United. You may also email the producer directly via leebaker27@gmail.com. This program has been distributed through the courtesy of Atheist United.